Hello,
I'm
everyone. Welcome
just
to the GOCC. Today, we have Kieran Martin from Iowa State University to talk with us, and they will be talking about perfect necklaces and universal partial cycles as generalizations of the de Broglie sequences. However, before I hand it off, I wanted to remind everyone of our community statement. This is an important part of our colloquium, and the first part is we are all learning. Everyone has something to contribute and no one has all the answers. So if you have any questions during the talk, you're free to unmute yourself and ask them to the speaker directly or direct it through the host and chat. And with that said, Kieran, take it away.
Hello, thank you for having me. It's really a pleasure to be invited. So I'm going to be talking about perfect necklaces and universal partial cycles. My talk, I don't have like a layout, an outline page. So I'm just going to like point at the bullets at the top here real quick, that I'm going to briefly recap what de Broglie sequences are and representations thereof on graphs. I might maybe talk a little bit, I don't know how tight I'll be on time, but I might talk a little bit about ways to generate them that are known. Then I'm going to talk about perfect necklaces, which are actually my current primary focus for research. So the section is fairly short, but it is really important. This is not the order that I discovered these in the course of my actual research. While researching, I was introduced to de Broglie sequences and then jumped straight into upcycles or universal partial cycles. And so that's going to be this long section here. The majority of my work with Dylan Fillmore and Bennett Gechner and Rachel Kirsch and Daniel McGinnis on an RTG a couple years ago that we've been continuing research on since, is to do with universal partial cycles. But an important key that we discovered only this year are in fact perfect necklaces. And so I want to go through sort of not in chronological order that I discovered this, but in what I think is a pretty intuitive dig into this material, finishing up with one of the major results from the paper that we'll be putting out surely sometime in the near future. It's just definitely how that goes. Okay, so let's get started. Is there anything else on this page I need to say? No, I don't think so. Okay, yeah, featuring joint work with these people. That's this section in particular. Okay, so what is a de Broglie sequence? A de Broglie sequence is a type of universal cycle, which is to say that it visits every object, every example of a combinatorial object exactly once for some class of combinatorial things. In this case, it's a universal cycle for all n length words on some alphabet A. So I'm going to use this scripty capital A for my alphabet and lowercase a for the size of that alphabet. For example, the sequence 000, I'm not going to read all of these off, but this one's short enough that I can. 00010111 is an example de Broglie sequence with binary alphabet and word length 3. We can verify this by just sort of tracking through each of the windows, the n length consecutive digits of this cycle to say that 000 appears and 001. And we can track through to say that every word, importantly, this is cyclic. So we also are counting wraparound 110 and 100. Every word in this alphabet raised to the word length appears exactly once, and that's what we're looking for. Because of that, the length of a de Broglie sequence will always be the alphabet size raised to the word length. Okay, another example that I'll let you track through yourself if you'd like in your free time, with alphabet size 4 and word length 2 is this here. So when you're going through this, it's just a matter of saying 00, 01, 10, 02, 20, 03, et cetera. And double checking that every word is present. There are never going to be repeats. So you can always like check the length of the thing and then double check that nothing appears twice. These sorts of techniques to make sure that this is an actual De Bruijn sequence.
A short question. Is it clear that stuff like this exists?
Yeah, it is. And I will say that on this next slide. It's not clear. I don't know, maybe. But there are representations that make it clear. So what does this look like? This appears on a De Bruijn graph, which is defined by having a vertex set where each vertex is one of the n-length words on our alphabet. And edge set, where you're connecting one word to the next, if and only if it's possible to shift one window over to see that next word. So you'll wind up with connections from any four digits to the last three of those digits and one of the alphabet letters appended on the end. So with this graph, we can talk about, okay, well, what would a De Bruijn sequence have to look like? Well, it would be a path where you're following each of these edges from one vertex to another in such a way that you see each of the vertices exactly once, which of course is a Hamilton cycle on this graph. It equivalently can be represented as an Euler tour on a graph, on the De Bruijn graph, with word length one less, which is really interesting because in this case, let's see. Okay, there are a couple facts to be clear about, that this larger dimension is actually just the line graph of this smaller dimension for all n. For all De Bruijn graphs, that will be true. And so when we're talking about labeling these vertices as the words of length n, you can think of each of the edges on this graph as similarly labeled, an edge that goes from 000 to 001 represents the word that starts with three zeros and ends with 001. So this will represent the word 0001 will be this edge here. Okay, so each edge in one dimension smaller represents one of these n length words as well. And so we can talk about whether these graphs are Eulerian, which is easier to check than whether they're Hamiltonian. If these graphs are Eulerian, then their line graphs are Hamiltonian. And so like these sorts of things, these are equivalent representations. So I've left the one on the right blank because I don't want it to just look like I've highlighted every edge. It is sort of important to do it in real time, I guess. But this, the way that you would do this same thing. So for the Hamilton tour, we're starting at say 0000. And then we can just append digits, follow the track to the next vertices according to the digits that we're adding to this cycle. So we start at 000. We want to append a 1, and a 1, and a 1, and a 1, wind up at 1111. Then we want to append a 0 to 1110, 100, 1011. And then to bring it back around, we have 0000 to wind up where we started. Okay, so we can confirm that this is a De Bruijn sequence, that this is a Hamiltonian cycle. Equivalently, we can start with this edge 0000, leading from the zero word to itself. And then because this is a cycle, because this is going to be cyclic, we can do the same thing, actually. We can just append digits and follow edges that associate with those. So we want, 1111, then 0100, 1011, and 0000. Zero, and I suppose I counted this at the very beginning. But so we can do the exact same thing as an Euler tour. which is really interesting to me because when I came into doing research with Rachel and Bennett, they had some kind of concept about what a Hamilton equivalent would be for upcycles, but they didn't know what an Euler equivalent would be. And so that was a lot of my contribution early on in our research. Okay, so what do these look like? Well, we can guarantee that they're Eulerian because they are strongly connected. To reach any given location from any other location, you just follow the digits labeling that vertex. And the in degree will always equal the out degree will equal A in particular. So this will always be Eulerian, which implies that the next size up will always be Hamiltonian. And so either of these representations will always exist. There will always exist a de Bruijn sequence. In finally answer to your question. So this is really cool. I think de Bruijn graphs are beautiful. I've drawn a lot of them. They get a bit out of hand as your parameters start to get big. You notice this is n equal to just 2 still. I mean, I guess I had n equal to 4 here, but just on a binary alphabet. And so they get really big. But they're full of symmetries. They're really, really beautiful structures. And so I really have liked working with them in a visual sense. Okay, so generalizing from that then, what is a perfect necklace? Okay, so this is a term that doesn't sound a lot like the original. Okay, a perfect necklace is a generalization where in addition to alphabet and word length, we also want to consider a shift parameter T. So what we're going to require is that each word appear exactly once per location mod T in the cycle. So for example, this is going to be a lot longer, right? We have T times as many words showing up. So the sequence here is shown is a perfect necklace. You will notice I have little dots under some of the digits. That's just to keep track of my shift parameter so that when I do things like this, I can pretty easily see, okay, this one is at location 0 mod t, this one location 1, this one location 2 mod t. So none of those are in the same position from the perspective of this shift parameter. So that's exactly what we want to require from one of these. We want to, and I'm just going through the words in the same order as I did the last one. There's no particular order that I'm not tracking like one window at a time over because there will be 3 copies of everything and that would be redundant. So I'm doing this in the same order as last time, but you can see there's no real predictable spread of these. In a perfect necklace, there's no like, it's not just a de Bruijn sequence that's pasted 3 times in a row, although it could be under certain circumstances of relative primality of this and some combination of these. But also like sometimes they're totally clustered. Sometimes they're perfectly separated or evenly spaced. And all sorts of things, but we'll see that every word in the relevant alphabet raised to the word length appears exactly t times at t different locations mod t. And that's exactly what we're looking for. So this will be t times as long a sequence. So what do these look like? This was a really fun question to answer. It took me a really long time. I dug into this before we knew that perfect necklaces existed even. I was hunting down this graph in my mind, trying to describe this object that we needed for the upcycles. And so we finally discovered a paper by Alvarez et al. That's just called Perfect Necklaces. And they say very clearly this definition, and they give a definition of an astute graph, which it's possible if you have any history in geometry that you may have seen such a thing called a Preger-Zhu graph, as in Cheryl Preger-Zhu, that has existed since the 1990s, I suppose. The first paper is in 1989, but the first paper has a different definition of the graph that I'm not sure is equivalent to the later definitions. And so I'm not sure about it. But certainly this is a directed version of a Prager-Joux graph as it's currently defined in the literature. But an astute graph. Okay, so they gave this definition based on just the vertex set, which is a two parameter label. You have a word from the de Bruijn sequence and you have some location in the shift. And the edge set is exactly all the same edges that would be present in a de Bruijn graph, except that instead of these being directed to their internal sort of segments, they're directed to the next one over. And so what this turns out to be, of course, is just a tensor product of these two graphs. This is a de Bruijn graph tensored with a cycle of some length, t. And so we can think of these as t copies of the de Bruijn graph, where each copy, instead of directing internally to itself, is just directing to its neighbor. In a cycle. So I originally drew this slide in black, in just black. And I was like, oh man, this astute graph is, it's just a ton of lines crisscrossing all over one another. So I should really add color to this. I should make this like all the edges that go, that mean you're appending a zero will be red, and all the edges where you're appending a one will be blue. And that'll make this all clearer. And so now I have this bowl of red and blue spaghetti instead of just black spaghetti. Okay, maybe technically a little bit clearer. But in particular, okay, this is a tensor product. So every vertex in this graph is just a combination of a vertex in each of these. So this vertex's label would just be the all zeros word, comma, zero. Right, and this would be all zeros comma one and all zeros comma two. Okay. Yes, and edges are the same. In fact, the Hamilton cycle and the Euler tour, this relationship between n minus one and n dimension of these graphs is exactly the same as a de Bruijn graph. The line graph of the astute graph is the astute graph where n has been incremented by one. And so that's very nice. We can talk about this as Euler tours, where we're covering every edge in this graph, or we can talk about this as reaching every vertex exactly once on the next larger degree.
A quick question as I'm trying to remember my graph theory. So a tensor product of graphs as opposed to a direct product of graphs is where your vertices are direct products of vertices, and an edge exists if and only if it's an edge in both of the graphs.
Yes,
absolutely. As opposed to an edge in either one of the graphs, nothing in the other. Okay.
Exactly, yes, that is correct. The edges in the astute graph exist if and only if they exist both in the de Bruijn graph and in this cycle. Of course, that just means that we don't have any loops here, so we won't have anything that looks properly like a de Bruijn graph unless this is a solitary cycle, I suppose. If you have a single point, then I suppose it's considered just a loop.
Good old C1.
Yeah, in this case. So, but yes, so a de Bruijn graph is going to be a trivial example of an astute graph where the shift is equal to just one, which is this idea of having just one vertex and a loop on it being the smallest case. But in all other cases, you're talking about a de Bruijn graph where all of its edges are just directed to its neighbor. Like de Bruijn graphs, these are strongly connected. It's a little bit harder to show that, or a little bit less intuitive to see that. But in particular, you just have to make sure that you can take any route. Okay, so if you're starting at a vertex u, you can take any route to be in the correct shift position to be n digits away from whatever you're aiming for, and then follow just exactly the digits labeling that word so that you arrive at the right word in the De Bruyne graph, essentially, while also obtaining the correct shift parameter for whatever vertex you're aiming for. So you have to like make sure you're getting to the right shift first, and then plug in the actual digits of the word to follow to the correct location. So it's strongly connected, exactly like a De Bruyne graph. It has in degree equal to out degree equal to A. And so these are always Eulerian, hence perfect necklaces always exist. This is another big question. This question, strangely, isn't directly answered by the perfect necklaces paper. They count how many there are, but they give this huge combinatorial expression for like several layers of notation deep for how many there are for any given parameters. But the most important thing for my research group is just that that was always non-zero. Like, this is always a positive number. This will always be Eulerian, so these will always exist. Cool. What if the shift is just two? Then this looks like just a bipartite thing. It'll be t-partite in general. And this is a trivial case. Okay. Let's see. So moving on, perfect necklaces will come back though, I promise. So what is a universal partial cycle? This is a sort of a heavy shift in direction, totally different generalization. This is where I started on this study 2 years ago, I think. What's the date? Yeah, that should be right. and so this is where I came into all of this. A universal partial cycle, commonly called an up cycle, is a different generalization where we're not talking about shift anymore. We're going back to just talking about each word is going to be covered exactly once at some point throughout the cycle. Okay, but in addition to letters, we also include a wildcard symbol, which we're going to represent with a diamond. So this wildcard can stand for any character. That's going to result in this being a lot denser than a De Bruyne sequence. Anytime you have a diamond, that means that you've collapsed this by a factor of A. So let's see, we require that this appears exactly once. The study stems from the study of universal partial words in a non-cyclic way, such as the n-length word of all diamonds. This is an interesting example to me because it's always people's first thought. When I introduce the idea of upcycles, people's first question is, oh, like this cycle of all diamonds. Like, well, couldn't you just do this? So pop quiz, why can't you just do that for an upcycle, even though you can for a word? Why will that not work?
I guess then the words will show up multiple times when you go around in this.
Exactly. When you start counting wrap around, this is going to have n copies of every word. And so this actually will not be an upcycle example, even though it is an up word. Okay. Let's see, other facts about up words. It was proven by Chen et al., I believe, that any non-binary alphabets for universal partial words have to be able to be written cyclically. And so the study of universal partial cycles is a natural extension if everything that's non-binary has to be a cycle anyway. Let's see, what else? Rachel and Bennett, my two collaborators, showed in their previous paper, I believe, that diamonds in an up cycle have to be n periodic. And so the term diamondicity or diamond density was coined to talk about how many diamonds per window there are, because for any window throughout the cycle, you will be able to see the same number of diamonds since they are n periodic.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
So diamond to the end. N is not an upcycle, but what about just one diamond?
Just one diamond.
Can you have cycles of length less than N where you...
I suppose you're not allowed to repeat characters. That's a good question. Okay. When you read out a word, you don't wrap to the extent that the word is wrapping on itself. That's a really good question. So if you had just diamond, then the only thing that you can cover is every word of length one.
Okay.
That's a very good question. I haven't thought about that. Okay, an example, back to binary alphabet with n equal to 4. Okay, this is significantly denser than the example we had before. This is an upcycle on the same parameters as the original de Bruijn sequence Hamiltonian cycle that we saw on the graph, so significantly longer. The sequence 001 star 110 star is a universal partial sequence with a equal to 2 and n equal to 4. And we'll see as we track window by window through this, each time you take a diamond into account, you're actually counting A words at a time. So each window in this cycle is covering A words at the same time. And so you can count the same, including wraparound, and verify that every word in the relevant alphabet to the word length appears exactly once. So this is indeed an upcycle. Every upcycle, what I had just said, will cover A to the D words per window, actually, technically. In this case, the diamond density or diamondicity is equal to 1 since each window is just 4 digits. And so the length of an upcycle will always be A to the N minus D. So we have de Bruijn sequences, which are A to the N. We have perfect necklaces, which are some multiple of A to the N. And then we have upcycles, which are some factor of A smaller than the de Bruijn sequence for the same parameters. So what does this look like? This was a big question when we first started looking into this a couple years ago. What does this look like? Because you can make a Hamiltonian cycle-like structure in the same de Bruijn graph for A and N. It turns out you can equivalently make an Euler-like substructure of A and N minus 1. De Bruijn graph. But what's interesting is that these substructures, this is just a reminder of the definition for this graph. But these substructures have choice built in, which is really interesting. Instead of just being a Hamilton cycle or an Euler tour, these are structures where you're bound to a path. So the way that I've colored this is once you start onto a colored path, you have to stay on that path, which is very clear in the Hamilton example, less clear in the Euler tour without coloring. But as soon as you start onto this green path, you are bound to take a 001 as your next digits, for example. So if you start with 001 and then you have a diamond where you're able to go either direction here, then you're bound to 110 in both of those paths. Then you have a diamond, you're able to take either direction. And of course, this 001 diamond appears again as you cycle around. Like this is, I have these highlighted here, not because that's part of the intended coloring, but to remind myself to point out that these switch points, oh, interesting. There's a question in the chat. Yes, a diamond would have N equal to D. Oh yeah. Could be seen as a valid upcycle. Okay, let's see. If n equal to d So a to the 0 equals 1. It has the right length, and it will cover everything exactly once, technically. It should be a valid trivial upcycle. Yeah, I agree. Trivial length upcycle. No, that's really interesting. It's like a, would it just be a single dot with a bunch of loops on it or something? I'm not sure. Or like a completely connected graph. Something. Word length one. Yeah. But yes, we have these switch points here where these diamonds allow us to make a choice as we're going through here. And we'll see later that we can actually unfold these into Hamilton cycles or Euler tours to form de Bruijn sequences from these upcycles, which is really interesting. Can you do that from an upcycle to another upcycle? Can you, it opens up a lot of questions. Anyway, when you start to question, okay, the Euler equivalent here, these diamond labeled vertices are the equivalent of these switch points in the Hamilton version of this, where each time you arrive at one of these vertices, you have the ability to make a choice for which direction to go out. And of course, in the upcycle, you take both directions at the same time. And then you're limited to, okay, next you have to take 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1 to arrive at the next switch point where you would split again. So it's very interesting. Notice all of the examples I've given so far also only have diamondicity equal to 1. Okay, what does a universal partial cycle look like? I think that was the title of the last slide too. Never mind. For larger examples, similar to de Bruijn sequences, but much worse, the same reason that I left this other one blank so that it didn't just look like I had highlighted every edge. It becomes a lot more difficult to clearly portray these as Euler tour analogs. I have in my tablet a sketch of this graph on the right where I had started to try to color in this same Euler tour, and it's so messy. this is already just a bowl of absolute spaghetti, and then trying to color this, it needs at least 4 colors. But then you have the same colors passing through the same vertices. I found to color it, if I was going to color it in the same way, by the same logic that I had colored this one, it would take 64 colors. It becomes a lot more unruly. However, my collaborator, Rachel Kirsch, had sort of, before we started working on this, before I started working on this at least, had sort of conceptualized this idea of using some substructure of the de Bruijn graph to display an upcycle. In this case, this is an A4N4 upcycle, if you read starting anywhere really, but around the outside of this. And this graph is just exactly the same as this one, where you have this outer ring, inner ring, and you have switch points between them. But for a much larger example, I think there are some 256 edges or something, or maybe just vertices. Anyway, so on this diagram, the way that this is laid out, maybe I can zoom in here a bit. These switch points are saying that you can take any option out of this diamond, but then regardless of what option you've chosen, you have these fixed digits that you have to take those vertices in that order. And so this is exactly equivalent to the other diagram that I had shown. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say for diamondicity that's higher than 1, it's not going to look quite as nice as this. It's going to have A to the D layers, and each of the switch points is not going to be just a complete bipartite looking thing anymore. It's going to be some layers can lead to some other layers at a given switch point, which is really interesting.
So to make sure I'm understanding this, that this top switch point at 12 o'clock, mm-hmm. No matter how you enter into it, you're entering in on a yellow path. So you must be on the second outer ring when you end.
That is a fair thought, but this is, the rings are really only indicating what you took for the last diamond.
Okay.
So each of these layers is saying, this is what I took for the most recent diamond I've seen.
Okay.
So yeah, the layers are 0, 1, 2, 3, like you were noticing. Mm-hmm. And everything else is colored in such a way that you have this fixed path, 3, 3, 2, regardless of what you took for your last diamond, because in the cycle, it is written diamond 3, 3, 2, right? And so once you shift your window over one, then you'll have total freedom to move to whichever layer you want to in the diamondicity equal to one case.
Okay.
And if you find a Hamilton cycle through this, that is going to be a de Bruijn sequence. It will be an unfolding of this upcycle. And so theoretically, yeah, you can just take all the threes and then all the twos and then all the ones and all the zeros. And then at the last minute, jump back to the three. Okay. That's perfectly valid. I was like, will we see why? We'll at least see an example. I'll at least talk about that more. But that's really interesting. So, okay, we wind up, like, the Euler tour representation is really nice, but it gets really unwieldy. Whereas if you have an example upcycle, then the Hamilton representation is very easy to write out, regardless of what your parameters are. So, yeah, unfolding, great. this is my real bread and butter of this stuff. This is one of our major results and something that I contributed a lot to. So, so looking at an upcycle like this, you might imagine unfolding this into a de Bruijn sequence by simply pinning down a choice for each of these diamonds as you go through. And it turns out when diamondicity is equal to one, this is trivially easy. You can make any choice in any order as long as each diamond that you come across eventually sees every possible option. That makes sense because you need every possible word being covered by that window. Okay, so that's perfectly fine. This is a notation that I'm going to use in the future as well, where here we're taking A to the D copies of our upcycle for the purpose of expressing A to the D different options here. And then we're going to cut and paste them side by side, just one after another, to form the unfolded de Bruijn sequence. So one can check that this is in fact a de Bruijn sequence that we got by making some choice for these diamonds from the outset. We started at 001 and we chose 0 first, so we followed this path. Then we chose 1, so we followed the other here. And then our next choices are fixed because there are only 2 alphabet letters. Okay. So 0, 1, 1, 0 is showing up, and that's interesting. It will be interesting that is showing up. Okay, so what if diamondicity is greater than 1? How does that affect this? Well, it is an open question. I welcome people digging into that. It's an open question whether diamondicity greater than 1 exists. We have no examples. It's my intuition that it does, but I flip-flop. I've worked on it for 2 years now, and I have many, many, many drawings of what such a thing would have to look like. And we have yet to come to any contradiction that that couldn't happen. So it's just really interesting. The astute graph that perfect necklaces trace out turns out to be very, very similar in shape to what a higher diamondicity path through through a De Bruyne graph would have to look like. And so the question becomes like, can I push an astute graph into a De Bruyne graph? Like, can I do that? That's where my brain is at this point on it. It has the right number of edges and things, sort of by design though. Okay, so can I make this sort of path shape through a De Bruyne graph is where I'm at. Okay, well, I welcome collaboration. it's an open question whether this exists, but if it does, then the process of unfolding definitely requires more care because these diamonds can see one another suddenly. They can contradict one another. They can cause repeated words where they wouldn't otherwise have been able to, and things like that, depending on your choice of individually what order you take these letters. So let's sort of build up into what has to happen for these. First, to successfully unfold any given diamond, because it's n-periodic for any upcycle, if you hope to unfold an upcycle into something that's legitimate, a De Bruyne sequence is technically a trivial upcycle with diamondicity equal to zero. So I'll say if you want to unfold a De Bruyne, a universal partial cycle into any other universal partial cycle, then you'll have to unfold diamonds at least in families of n-periodic sort of collections of them. Because if you have a diamond after unfolding that is not n away from some other diamond, then this is no longer an upcycle. To that end, if n divides the length of the upcycle, then you can, regardless of how high diamondicity is, you can collect just a family of every diamond that's n apart and say, okay, I want to unfold only those ones first, and none of those ones can see each other, so I can do that in any way I want. Can take any arbitrary ordering of how to unfold this one and this one and this one. They won't contradict one another. And when I'm done unfolding that sort of class of diamonds, I will have diamondicity one less. So if n divides the length, then you can always step from diamondicity just down one tier to diamondicity one less. You might imagine that the likelihood of n dividing a to the n minus d as d gets, well, let's see, as d gets smaller, that'll get more possible. Is that right? Yeah, okay. So fair enough. If you can do this, then you should be able to do it all the way down. Okay. But what if n doesn't divide the length of the upcycle? What's going to happen then? What will that look like? If n does not divide the length of the upcycle, then you definitely will not be able to just select a single family of n-periodic diamonds to unfold in one step, because the distance between them, right, is going to necessarily wrap. This won't jump just back to this first diamond, it'll jump to the second one, right? And so you will necessarily be taking larger steps down. What else? There are examples of n not dividing a to the n minus d, but only trivial, only De Bruyne sequences so far. So, which makes sense. That should make sense, because I'm saying that it's impossible to step one down. But my large claim is that it's always possible to unfold directly to a De Bruyne sequence. So that's interesting. Okay. Anyway, if you were going to try to select a sort of a maximal n-periodic class of these diamonds to unfold, you would not be able to avoid them being in the same window. In this case, we will need a way to guarantee that not only that each diamond is seeing each letter as it unfolds, but every pair of diamonds in this case, because we have two per window that are seeing each other of the ones we want to unfold, okay? But that every possible interaction between these diamonds is going to be seen exactly once. So how are we going to do that? Okay, let's, just for notation's sake, call delta the number of diamonds to unfold per window. So maybe you aren't necessarily unfolding all of them, but you are stuck with multiple per window. Okay, so let's see, delta will equal the original diamondicity minus the anticipated diamondicity of the result. Unfolding this will require A to the delta copies because you want every possible interaction to show up. Okay, so this is the, this looks a lot more complicated than a few slides ago, but it's the same notation that I was using here, right? This is, we're taking the upcycle, we're identifying what order can we take the letters for each of these diamonds, such that when we paste that all together, we'll get a de Bruijn sequence. Or I guess in this case, we're not taking all of the diamonds out, so a smaller diamondicity upcycle. So how can we unfold this such that every word in our alphabet raised to the delta appears exactly once at every one of these positions without ever contradicting each other? Okay, well, this looks really messy. Okay, so let's throw out everything that we don't actually need. Focus only on the diamonds that we care about, and we'll mark what I'm using LaTeX notation here for the copies of upcycles that are adjacent. Let's see, consider just the diamonds. There are altogether in this original upcycle, we're hoping to unfold delta over n times the length of the upcycle, that is the proportion of digits that are these diamonds times the length. So that's the number of diamonds that we're hoping to unfold altogether. And each copy of this upcycle has to exhibit a distinct delta length word because there are delta of them per window that can see each other, given a fixed position in the cycle. So we can't have the same word appear here and here, right? So in fact, this notation is dubiously similar to my dot notation earlier, keeping track of the shift. This object is precisely a perfect necklace for the alphabet A, word length delta, and shift equal to the total number of diamonds that we're unfolding. And this was like big brain moment for us. Like when we realized like perfect necklaces exist, we'd called it a unicorn orderings, something that you could fill this in such a way that it would work. We had a recipe for unicorn soup, and it was all good to go as long as you could find a unicorn. And then we found this paper, Perfect Necklaces, that describes actually exactly the thing we were talking about and how many there are and how to represent them on graphs and all sorts of things. Beautiful, beautiful 2016 paper, Alvarez et al. Okay. but this was a huge moment for us to realize we had been sort of winding around to this conclusion that you always can do this thing, probably, as long as this structure exists. But it should always exist, right? Like, you should be able to find something like this. And so we had been digging into things. Okay, but this is beautiful. So this is just a perfect necklace of the correct parameters. And I see somebody, that sounds like a de Bruijn sequence. Oh no. I didn't read it soon enough. Now I don't know what a de Bruijn sequence is.
Don't worry about it. It turned out to be a perfect necklace.
Okay. Yeah, yes. Okay, the thing that we're looking for. Exactly. Yes. Okay, that makes sense. Yeah, how can we unfold this such that this appears exactly once? But the reason it's not just a de Bruyne sequence is because we're not just managing, like our shift isn't just one. Our shift is actually going to be very long, and we're talking about these delta length words that have to appear at every position. So yes, it is a perfect necklace, exactly. And so our major conclusion in this section is that every upcycle can be unfolded or lifted to a de Bruyne sequence by unfolding the diamonds according to this perfect necklace. You don't have to do this in like sets of families of, like I was saying, you don't have to do this in minimal steps, but there exist minimal steps. It's worth noting that you can't just step down one by one, but you can always just jump straight there by following a perfect necklace of this size, which, as mentioned earlier, always exists because the astute graph is always Eulerian, and an Euler tour of the astute graph will give you a perfect necklace. And so these will always be possible. Moreover, an upcycle with diamondicity D can be lifted to an upcycle with diamondicity D prime, smaller than D, as long as there exists a maximal collection of n periodic diamonds, such that exactly delta of them lie in each window, by unfolding the diamonds of that collection according to this delta related perfect necklace. And that is what I'm talking about here, where as long as you can single out a family of diamonds such that there are delta of them in each window, then you can step down by that amount of diamondicity. And that is the talk and some sources things. Does anybody have other questions?
First, let's thank the speaker. And now, yes, any questions for Kieran?
And all these slides will be posted on the website, Mark has assured me. So yes. If you want to actually look up any of these references, you don't have to dashedly write it down now or anything. The last of these, do I have these in date order? Yes.
You do.
So perfect necklaces is older than the upcycles stuff, which is wild to me. There's one paper that references the perfect necklaces paper that I've been able to find in the literature, and it has nothing to do with what we're doing naturally. I mean, what we're doing is like deep into upcycles, we needed this construction to be able to do a specific thing, and it just happens that the key to being able to do that is a perfect necklace. And so our research dug really deep over here and then led directly to that paper. So that's fascinating to me that has existed since 2016. It's existed for 6 years and we had no idea.
Yeah, no, it's more argument for just math for math's sake, because you never know the random thing you're doing is popping up somewhere else. But I did have a question I was going to give other people a chance to ask. The first question is, what was the delta parameter again?
Delta is the difference between the diamondicities that you're hoping to unfold. Here we go. Yeah, delta is just the diamondicity that you're starting with minus the diamondicity that you're going to result with. You're unfolding delta of these per window, and so the number of diamonds per window will have been decreased.
Okay, and so when and so I was just trying to figure out if the original tool for unfolding was just a special case of your general theorem where your shift was equal to one.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
I should have mentioned that. This 0, 1, 1, 0. This is a perfect necklace with shift equal to one.
Okay.
This is a 2, 1. Nope. 2, 1 perfect necklace.
I've got other questions, but I really do want to allow other people to ask them.
Okay, I do have a question, but maybe it's not a question for a pure mathematician. So I know that De Bruyne graphs and sequences show up in bioinformatics.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know anything about applications of upcycles?
I do not. it would be really interesting. I don't know how it would be implemented, because De Bruyne's sequences, you're right, have applications in like genetics. This is every possible combination of GCAT, right? As densely packed as possible, or something like that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and so this clearly has applications of packing a lot of information very densely. I don't know what an analog to that would be for, I mean, for a perfect necklace. This is sort of similar in flavor maybe to like a, what's called like a K-fold. I guess this would be a T-fold De Bruyne sequence that might clearly have applications if you want this for a number of times that you want to see everything. Okay. But for an upcycle, that's really difficult to imagine in a biology sort of sense. So I'm not sure. For me.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
As a pure mathematician, exactly. Like. No, that's a good question. I'm not sure.
Okay, I've got more questions. So first is that you've got these diamond sequences that can unfold into De Bruyne sequences.
Yes.
Do you have any idea of, you know, how many De Bruyne sequences come from unfolded diamond sequences?
Yes, exactly the number of perfect necklaces, in fact, which is, as I mentioned, a complicated combinatorial expression. But yes, exactly that many. It is if and only if, in fact. Which well, we're editing our paper now, and that's like a proof, not this proof, but a proof that's really similar to this, where we also have results on like that you can find from any given upcycle, you can you can construct an upcycle with k times the alphabet size with the same diamondicity, the same word length. And the proof of that turns out to be very similar to this. You're using diamonds or non-diamonds. You're using a perfect necklace, that's what I'm trying to say, the word that came to mind was modulate. That's too much. to adjust the, yeah, well, it, what it winds up being is technically this, what it's the alphabet times a perfect necklace V, and then add that to your original copied A to the some number of times K to the D or something times. And that turns out to be an upcycle. That will be an upcycle with the same diamondicity, where you're multiplying and adding these things digit-wise. But anyway, the proof of that theorem is very similar to this. We were going through it just yesterday or something in our meeting, and nitpicking. I've lost my thread. Oh no. let's see. I have to rush. Have another meeting soon. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
We're over time.
You still left. We're gonna thank the speaker again, and we're gonna end the recording.